Governors, the Federal Open Market Committee, and Washington, D.C. Critics continue to challenge the resulting compromises. We have an ongoing, endless debate in the United States where further changes to the Federal Reserve Act and the operations of the Fed are proposed. Those proposals have only one characteristic in common, namely that they're viewed as undesirable by officials of the Federal Reserve System itself. The legitimacy of an institution like a central bank ultimately rests on two sources. The first one is input legitimacy. Acceptance of the institution derives from the process through which decisions are reached and power is exercised. If that process gives voice to and empowers the relevant stakeholders appropriately, and if the interests of different parties are weighed properly in decision making, then the institutions.
We continue with, and I invite Franklin Allen. You have written the 13th chapter together with Professor Gu and Professor Chen. The title is The People's Bank of China from 1948 to 2016. Please.
Thank you. I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to be involved in this project and this conference. Sweden is a wonderful country, and one of the many reasons for that is the strength of its institutions. And the Riksbank is a prime example of that. I've always greatly enjoyed my interactions with the Riksbank because it is such an honest and an interesting place to have discussions about central banking issues. Now I'm going to talk about the People's Bank of China. Now, China is the largest economy in purchasing power parity terms. In 2017, it was 20% bigger than the U.S., having overtaken it first in 2014. Now, projecting the future is always problematic, but if current kinds of growth rates continue, then by the mid-2020s, it could be 50% bigger than the U.S., and by the mid-2030s, twice as big. Now, as China's economy, and particularly its financial system, open up to the rest of the world, the actions of the People's Bank of China will become increasingly more and more important. However, its role and the way that it conducts monetary policy is little understood. What my co-authors and I, Jun Chan from Fudan University and Shan Gu from the Central University of Finance and Economics aim to do in this chapter is to shed light on how it has developed over time and how it currently operates. Now, before the foundation of the People's Bank of China in 1948, China had a long history of paper money going back 1,000 years roughly. Many of the dynasties used paper money, but they weren't successful in the sense that they usually ended up in hyperinflation and very bad results. Now, in 1948, as the Communist Party was close to victory, the People's Bank of China was founded. Now, during the period 1948 to 1978, its functions evolved in various ways. But essentially, its role was to help the planning ministry to implement the central plan. So their role was to provide the finance and so forth and the money that was needed for the central plan to work and for the economy to develop. Now, Now, during that time, it was a monobank in the sense that it essentially controlled the entire financial system of China, and it acted as both a central bank and a commercial bank. Now, in 1978, the commercial function started to be taken away from it, as the big five commercial banks, which are owned by the government, or majority owned by the government, became separate entities. So Industrial Commercial Bank of China, the Bank of China, and so forth. Now, in 1984, the People's Bank of China formally became that of the central bank. By that time, it had got rid of most of its commercial banking activities. Now, over time, it's developed in various ways. Today, its major mandates are to formulate and implement monetary policy, to guard against and eliminate financial risks, and lastly, to maintain financial stability. Now, to deal with the challenges from constantly changing internal and external environments, unlike central banks in most advanced economies, there's no single primary policy instrument. Instead, the PBC successfully combines a wide range of policy tools, and these include quantity-based instruments such as open market operations and reserve requirement ratios for commercial banks. They also have price-based instruments such as interest rates on bank deposits and lending, as well as on required and excess reserves and central bank refinancing. Now, the third thing that they use, which is quite interesting, is administrative window guidance. And this is quite different than most Western banks, but it's based on what the Bank of Japan did for many years. And whereas when we hear the word window, we think of something like a deposit window. That's not actually what goes on with this. So what they do is they meet with the commercial banks, and they give them suggestions about where they might want to channel their credit. And so it's a form of industrial planning, which is somewhat a natural successor to what they did during the central planning times. But it means they have tremendous power, because given the way China works, if the central bank suggests you do something, it's a very good idea to do it. I think in the medium and long term, the People's Bank of China has been quite successful using its combination of price-based, quantity-based, and administrative tools. And what it's been able to do is to realize a relatively lower inflation rate most of the time. There have been episodes of high inflation, as in the early to mid-1990s, but they fell back to reasonable levels fairly quickly. And they've been able, through that policy, to help with the fast economic growth rate that China has displayed for the last 30 years. And in addition, they've smoothed short periods of liquidity crunches, as in the early 2000s, and they've also helped the financial system get through episodes of turbulence in the stock market, most recently in 2014 to 15. Now, in addition to those more standard roles, they've also been involved in financial institution reforms. They've done a lot of interest rate liberalization. That's not quite complete, but it's to a large extent done. And they've also worked extensively on the reform of the RMB exchange rate regime. So overall, I would say it has been successful in achieving its mandate. And as I said initially, I expect it to become increasingly important on the global scene going forward. And as I say, I hope that we are able to develop an understanding of how it works, how it affects the global economy, because it is going to be very, very important if it does get to be twice as big as the US economy in China. Thank you.
lot for the interesting presentation, and maybe we can learn something here about the way they are handling the banks. But it sounds like it was here maybe in the 70s and 80s, so maybe we shall not take a step back. Thanks a lot. Now we have a last panelist, Mr. Issing, and you have written the history of a younger central bank. It's chapter 14, and it is about the European Central Bank. Floor is yours, please.
First, I would like to join my colleagues thanking for become part of this really tremendous project. We had already a pre-conference last year in which we could discuss several issues. My chapter of the ECB in this book is unique, not because of me, but because of the European Central Bank, which is so different in its birth, in its construction, its obligations in comparison to the other central banks. It's by far the youngest. Bank of Sweden, 350 years old, Bank of England, ECB, in 10 days' time is celebrating its 20th anniversary. So this is a tremendous distance in history. But it's unique also in the much more important aspect that it's for the first time in the history of mankind that sovereign countries have transferred their competence on monetary policy, on currency policy, to a new supranational institution and have remained sovereign in many respects. And this, from the start, of course, created tensions which continue until today. It's the only central bank also which the moment of its birth became the second most important central bank of the world. So a baby immediately emerging to the status. And also implicitly its currency, the euro, became the second most international important currency in the world. Not by by design, but just as a fact of the economic power, so to say, behind this project. Starting from scratch, has many disadvantages. You don't have a track record you can refer to. You have no reputation on your own because you have just started. But it also creates advantages because you have leeway to design your policy in a way. So the ECB, already 10 weeks before the start of taking responsibility for the euro, which is in mid-October 98, published its strategy. It will follow when taking over responsibility for the euro. I think this has never happened before. In this context, we have announced this strategy, the two-pillar strategy, but I would like to refer to one point in which you can see that not only economies were very, very heterogeneous, but also the spirit, the experience of participating countries and governors. The governing council is composed of the 6 members of the board and the governors of participating national central banks. This creates a very complex decision-making body. And when in October 98 I suggested that we should specify what our mandate, which is in the treaty, maintaining price stability, how it should be understood. My suggestion was to have a number to be responsible against. And the reactions of my colleagues came from 3 camps opposite to this idea. The first camp saying, why should we specify that maintaining price stability is fine enough and vague enough, why should we specify it? We will be made responsible if we deviate, if we don't deliver. And for example, the Bundesbank and other national central banks joining had never specified their goal. Bundesbank never. Implicitly only when deriving the monetary target. The other camp said, this is much too ambitious. Bundesbank over the DM over the 50 years of its existence had an average annual inflation rate of 2.8%. And we, as a new institution, announced 2%. This is too ambitious. And the third camp said, this is not ambitious enough. Why? Because the current inflation rate, which was delivered by national central banks, was much below 2%. It approached 1% in the moment of the start. The harmonized index of consumer prices was 0.8. So the concern was, if a new institution announces, so to say, our ambition will be to push inflation higher, today it sounds more familiar than at that moment, could have been seen a weakness of this. But, you know, this 2% has now been more or less become a number which is the global goal. I think the ECB also was free to set standards in several other aspects. It was the first central bank to have a press conference immediately after every monetary policy decision meeting with real-time information about the reasons why we decided so and not otherwise. And we were free also to design our operational framework because the treaty gives all the leeway. So the ECB has introduced a minimum reserve system remunerated to avoid distortionary effects. And we have established a deposit facility with, together with the marginal lending facility, created a framework, a range for the development of market rates. And it has worked very well until today. And if you look back how the ECB managed to organize a changeover from national central banks and currencies to the euro, you will not find any sign of this huge regime shift in monetary data and statistics. It's unbelievable. If you think about the skepticism which accompanied this new institution before the start. From the theory of optimal currency areas, we know that I would not rely on everything and make it exclusive criterion for choosing member states, but certainly these 11 countries joining and now the 19 don't fulfill the criteria of an optimal currency area. But one thing was really badly missing, which is flexible labor markets, product markets, mobility of labor. And this is a problem for the ECB until today, because the impact of the monetary policy decisions, interest rates decisions on this heterogeneous area is very much different from, let's say, an economy like the US. So to comparing actions of the ECB and the Fed is misleading, because they are conducted in a very different economic environment. The monetary policy of the ECB must be a single monetary policy. So one size has to fit all. And if it doesn't fit, national policies have to correct that. But they failed to do so. And the ECB until today is confronted with the failure of national governments on a broad range to do their job. So this brings the ECB almost unavoidably in a position which is compensating with its monetary policy for lack of flexibility in markets, lack of abiding to the rules of fiscal policy of the Stability and Growth Pact. And on top of that, the ECB also was mandated in the meantime with the task of banking supervision. I was a member of the De La Rossier Group and we warned against. But for establishing an independent supervisory authority, one would need a treaty change, and this for the time being is impossible. ECB is also playing a major role in macroprudential policies, so the tasks have increased over time. And to make an assessment of the record of the ECB. I'm of course somewhat biased. I think this has to be done on two levels. On monetary policy, the ECB was successful. The average annual inflation rate is below 2%. It's below 2%. This is a big success. It's a big success. So on its core task, the ECB is undisputed success. On its political role, I think this is a great challenge. The ECB is widely seen in the euro area as the only game in town, the only institution which can act and has acted decisively, but it brings the ECB in a role which is, I think, over time, not good, to say the least, for an independent central bank, because it is burdened with tasks which should remain in the realm of politics. And this leads back to, can the currency survive without a political union, monetary union without political union? How is the monetary union to be reformed to make it more less fragile in the context of crisis? These are the challenges with which the ECB will be confronted, I'm afraid, for some time to come.
Thanks to all of you for enlightening us on with your extremely broad and deep knowledge in the central bank history. Now you have an exposé here of the some of the banks that are described in our book, so I hope that you have got some appetite to read all the different chapters, because this is really interesting reading. I will not try to summarize, but I can see, I mean, there one conclusion is that there are quite many similarities when you study the different central banks. So, also when you have seen over time how central banks have been formed, it's sometimes been a gradual formation. Central banks have been formed in perspective of what has gone, what's the economy, what's happened in the economy around. But it's also sometimes been rather quick changes in the central bank's mandate, and it's often linked to crisis, economic crisis or financial crisis. And I think we can learn a lot from history, not necessarily that we can use that when we are mandated to do our monetary policy today, but we can learn and we can understand better how different measures can be used and what sort of effect it will have. So now we have, you have been very disciplined and I didn't need to use my red card, so we have some time for questions, and I have a few questions, but please prepare for your questions, because I will ask for questions within a few minutes. But having such a distinguished group here with such a broad knowledge, I think we shall not just talk about history. The next panel will focus on the future, so I thought maybe we could give them some input. And in the morning there was quite a lot of discussion about the independence of central banks, so if you could try to formulate some short answers on the independence issues. Do you think that independence still will be a prerequisite in 10 years' time, or will there be more coordination between monetary policy and fiscal policy? I start with my first question. So, Michael Bordo, can I ask you to start?
Okay, might be a bit contrarian here. I believe that central bank independence will be important 10 years from now. During the global financial crisis, central banks followed credit policy, which is a kind of fiscal policy, which is what they believe they needed to do to stem the crisis. And that, I think, threatened their independence from the fiscal authorities. and also central banks began using multiple tools and expanding their mandates to include financial stability. And these changes may have threatened their ability to follow their main mandate, which is to preserve the value of money. I think as the memory of the global financial crisis fades, I think that the risks to central bank independence from the expansion of the central bank's mandate and power may actually lead to pressures to retrench back towards their true mandate.
Thank you. Klaus, please. The micro, please.
Is it now? Yeah. It's working. Yes. 10 years ago, the Riksbank had no government, owned no government bonds at all, and now there's a substantial portfolio of government bonds. But I see all of that as governed by the ultimate demand, the inflation targeting regime. That this is a new tool to uphold the goal. So I don't see in itself that policy will threaten the inflation stabilization goal, because there is this is just secondary market buying. The government has not been involved in this at all. So there, I see no signs of tendencies towards fiscal dominance that we've had historically. But to me, that seems to completely different stories. I see no threat, and I see no need for coordination as such. Maybe other opinions.
Thank you, Charles Goodhart. Do you have a view about this?
I hope this is working. Is it working?
Yeah.
Okay. The arrival of China in the world's global trading system and Eastern Europe and other demographic factors had such a deflationary effect on the world at large that central banks have only been able to achieve their monetary targets by continuously bringing down interest rates, both nominal and real. And that, of course, makes them very popular with the politicians. But this is about to reverse, because the China effect is over, the demographic effect is about to go into reverse. So that the next 10 or 20 years are likely to be much more underlying inflationary than the last 20. If so, of course, in order to maintain price stability, interest rates will have to rise. At a time when fiscal pressures from people like me, the old, those needing medical assistance, are going to be much more expensive, that is going to put them immediately in conflict with the political powers. Under this circumstance, I think that quite a lot of central banks which currently have independence will lose it to more populist politicians, and the rest will have more difficulty in maintaining their independence than they've had over the last 30 years. So I think it's, I hope you central bankers have enjoyed the last 20 years, because the future, I think, is going to be more difficult than the last 20 years.
Thank you. Barry Eichengreen, please.
I think there may be an emerging consensus. The way I would put it is that the case for central bank independence is strong but not unproblematic. The case, as you will know, is based on the ability of independent central banks to make time-consistent decisions and on insulation from special interest capture. The reality is that central banks have a limited stock of independence. They have a limited stock of autonomy. They have a limited stock of political capital. They need to be judicious about how and when to expend it. I don't agree with my friend Michael that central banks can or should go back to a storied past where they just set interest rates and didn't do anything else. I think the world of monetary and financial policy has moved on. The world is now too complicated to realistically revert to that model, and that's why I think there will be new complications for independent central banks. They can try to deal with those complications by being more transparent. They can try to deal with them by being more representative and therefore more legitimate, and they can hope.
Thanks a lot, Franklin.
So, People's Bank of China, of course, is not independent, and in President Xi's China, it's not going to be independent 10 years from now, and I think that will change some views about it over time. I guess I would agree with Charles to a large degree. I think it's going to come under great pressure, not only for the reasons he gave, but for another very important reason, which is many countries have very large stocks of debt after the financial crisis. And I think in particular for the ECB, this is going to be a huge problem. So if you think of Italy with 130% of GDP in debt, and at least it looks under the current government as that probably won't go down, but rather will go up. Every time the ECB puts up interest rates by 1%, they've got to come up by, in the long term, with 1.3% of GDP to pay the interest on that debt. And that's going to cause a lot of frictions. And we already see those kinds of frictions coming out with the proposal for these mini BOTs that the government may introduce in Italy. But it's not just in Italy. If you look at the Congressional Budget Office projections for US debt, they are quite astronomical in terms of where they're going to be in 15 or 20 years' time. And again, you have this problem that as the central bank, as the Fed, pushes up interest rates, they're going to have to raise a considerable amount more in taxes to pay the interest. So I think it will come under great pressure.
Thank you.
I would like to put my answer in the context of the empirical evidence on central bank independence. Around 1990s, the number of central banks in the world given independence increased dramatically. And it seemed that this is now the optimal institutional setting. Independent central banks with a clear limited mandate maintain price stability or keep inflation low and stable. It reminds somewhat of like Fukuyama, the end of history. It's the end of history, and it's not the end of history. And if you look into history, I've learned from Lars that independence of decades in waves and disappeared, etc. So we should not forget that the great moderation seemed to indicate that this is indeed the best arrangement you could see. It worked well. No inflation and decent growth and high employment. And when central banks saved the world from falling into a Great Depression, the reputation of central banks even increased. But I think from experience, from history, one should know that if institutions go to such a level, their reputation is at stake because expectations are going too far. And central banks cannot match these expectations. And they have not done enough to tell the public, come on, we are central banks, what can we do and what is not in the reach of our possibilities. So I'm afraid that there will be some disappointments, tensions with fiscal policies, as Franklin and Charles have referred to, political roles they have taken over, coordination with fiscal policies, banking supervision. All these are elements which will be used to attack central banks, and we should not forget the legitimacy of independence of a central bank in the democracy is always at stake. It should always be discussed. And my orthodox, probably naive understanding of an independent central bank is keep the limits of your mandate, the limits of the legitimacy. And finally, we have to distinguish independence, de jure. In the case of the ECB, it's hard to change that. But de facto, how will central banks behave?
Thanks a lot. So now it's time for questions from you. Who would like to start? Now you have a great opportunity here with lots of knowledge about all the central banks on a global level. Yes, please, Stefan.
So I'm Stefan Gerlach. I think one thing that didn't come out perhaps as clearly as warranted, I think, is that sort of the role of the presence or absence of civil war, civil strife, foreign invasions and so on in making for successful central banks. The People's Bank of China is not the first central bank of China. This is a central bank of China, founded in 1922 and still has beautiful buildings in the mainland. Similarly, if you look at Germany, I mean, Germany has gone through a remarkable number of central banks in the last 100 years with the Reichsbank, the Rentenbank, the Bank Deutsche Länder, the Staatsbank in the DDR, the Bundesbank and the DCB. So I'm sort of wondering, what do the panel think about the role of absence of civil strife, actually, in shaping central banking institutions?
So who would like to answer? Is there a good answer on Stefan Gerlach's question? No? Yes? Otmar, please.
Stefan referred to the experience of Germany. It's all true what you said, and what people have forgotten, that central bank independence in Germany after the Second World War was imposed by the Allies in Germany. The British were not in favor of that, neither the French, but the Americans insisted of having a decentralized system out of the experience and having an independent institution. And this was imposed on the Germans before Germany, West Germany, as a country, as a federal state, existed only in 49. And it was the Bank Deutsche Länder, and when it came to design the law on the Bundesbank, Chancellor Adenauer was strongly against independence of the bank. Not surprising, a politician wants to have control of almost everything. So it was Ludwig Erhard who was his antagonist. But what has happened, and I think this is telling, the central bank had acquired in the meantime, in a very short period of time, of course special circumstances cannot be repeated, had acquired such a reputation that even Adenauer did not dare to go against the will of the people. So I think central bank independence in the end is supported by legal acts, but it's in the end supported by the people or not.
Yes, Michael, please.
I guess I agree with Otmar. I think that you need political stability to get the legitimacy to have a central bank that's credible. I think that's what history tells us. And when you have these periods of civil strife, the central bank is always going to be a victim of it, and then you have to regain it by regaining the stability that existed before.
Thanks a lot. Let's see. Are there one more question? Yes, Martin, please.
Thank you. So I'm Martin Flodén, I'm a deputy governor at the Riksbank. I have a question for Barry in particular, or maybe Otmar also. So Otmar, you said that the setup of the ECB was a unique development or thing happening in history. To some extent, of course, it was that we had sovereign monetary policies before, but there are also many parallels, I think, with the setup of the Fed. So if you reflect on the problems with facing the struggle between centralization, decentralization, north, south, in the US, do you think there are important lessons to learn for the ECB, or if we try to anticipate the future developments for the ECB? I'm thinking in particular of the governance of the ECB that you can develop.
Another one of Otmar's observations is that the Eurozone is not an optimum currency area. Of course, the United States is not an optimum currency area either. Flexibility could be greater. Labor mobility has been declining in the United States. There are asymmetric disturbances with very different regional economies. I don't want to exaggerate the comparison, but when I think about the history of monetary policy in the United States, a lot of that history surrounds conflicts between regions about what the appropriate monetary regime was from the 1870s through the 1890s, or what an appropriate level of interest rates and by implication an appropriate exchange rate is. The Federal Reserve was famously decentralized in the early years. The Federal Reserve Act did not specify with clarity whether the regional reserve banks had the autonomy to set their own discount rates, or whether they could set their own discount rates but had to receive the approval of the board, or and those matters were disputed for the better part of two decades, I think with rather disastrous consequences, especially in the period from the period from 1927 through 1933. So at the beginning of that period, the Federal Reserve Bank of New York was making consequential international monetary policy decisions basically for the whole system. In the depths of the Great Depression, cooperation between the regional reserve banks, each of which had to hold its own adequate gold cover under the gold standard then prevailing, that cooperation wasn't there. There were some famous episodes when the Chicago Fed wouldn't loan gold to the New York Fed, which was on the front lines of the banking and financial crisis. So that's what led to the Federal Reserve Act of 1935, which really centralized decision-making in Washington, D.C. When I was thinking about the structure of the ECB back before the ECB existed, I wrote a piece about that early U.S. history with the message that there would have to be a central executive board to make decisions. The good news is that there is one. The not so good news is that it's very large.
Thanks a lot. Yes, Charles Goodall, please.
I can't help remembering that the Wizard of Oz is an allegory of these conflicts between different sectors, the U.S. relating to the gold standard and central bank. And, of course, The Wind in the Willows was written by an official of the Bank of England. It's always suggested that Mr. Toad is actually a representation of the once governor of the Bank of England, Certain Walter Cutliffe, which leads me to hope that somewhere in the audience there's going to be a new author of a wonderful children's book, possibly related to conflicts within current central banks.
Thanks a lot. That will be, yes, Michael, would you like to add something?
Small point to follow up on what Barry said. So I agree with what Barry said about the problems in the 1920s and 30s with the federal system of the U.S. Central Bank. But what happened was that in the 1950s, under Chairman Martin, actually they worked out a new arrangement to allow the reserve banks to have a very important role in policy making, and many of the important changes in how policy were done from the 50s almost to the present, many of these ideas did come from the Reserve Banks from St. Louis, from Minneapolis, from Richmond. So in a sense, the compromise that came out starting in 1935 and then in the 50s did make the Fed a much more effective federal system.
So thanks. So that takes us to the end of our panel session, and I would like to thank the panel again for your outstanding contribution to the history of central banks. And I would also like to take this opportunity to thank the editors of the book, and that's Rodney Edvinsson, Tor Jakobsson, and Daniel Waldenström for hard work. I congratulate you to a unique book, well worth reading. So let's give the authors and the editors a big hand.
Justin for sharing this session, and thanks to all the authors for the contributions to the book, of course, but also for being here willing to celebrate this occasion with us here today. I have two pieces of practical information. Before you get the tea or coffee, there is a photo session in the stairway, so please join us so we can get the photo of everyone here together, so that we can show our grandchildren together with the book that Charles Goodhart talked about. If you haven't already picked up your entry card for tonight's dinner, a good opportunity to do that is in that direction in the stairway after the photo has been taken. We'll meet here again at 3:20.
Jaha. Vad händer?
Gäster, ärade medverkande, mina damer och herrar. I år jubilerar världens äldsta centralbank. Sveriges riksbank fyller historiska 350 år. Och riksdagen är tillsammans med Sveriges riksbank värdar för dagens jubileumskonferens om centralbanker igår, idag och imorgon. Som riksdagens talman är jag väldigt glad över att kunna välkomna er alla hit idag. Ett särskilt välkomnande vill jag naturligtvis rikta till er som representerar just Riksbanken. Välkomna hem, skulle jag nästan kunna säga. För det västra riksdagshuset var ju länge Riksbankens hem. Och än idag är det ett levande minne här i huset. Se bara på huvudentrén och den stora salen innanför huvudentrén som vi fortfarande kallar bankhallen. Eftersom det är 350 år av stolt tradition som vi uppmärksammar idag så vill jag gärna säga några ord om vår gemensamma historia. I slutet av 1800-talet så sökte Riksbanken ett nytt centrum för sin verksamhet, men också riksdagen behövde bättre lokaler för sin tämligen nya tvåkammarriksdag. De kungliga stallarna här på Helgeandsholmen revs för att ge plats åt de här två olika husen. Resultatet ser vi än idag, även om Riksbanken flyttade till Brunkebergs torg 1976. Så idag kamperar vi alltså inte längre ihop, men vi är fortfarande vänner, som det brukar heta. Med Riksbanken som är myndighet under riksdagen så har vi ju naturligtvis formaliserade band. Även om kopplingarna har sett olika ut under dessa 350 år. Några nedslag i historien går från Riksbankens föregångare som var avhängig kungens tillstånd vidare till det historiska grundandet 1668 av Riksens Ständers Bank som Riksbanken hette vid grundandet och fram till modern tidsordning. När de här vägvalen har gjorts så har alltid en central fråga handlat om allmänhetens och samhällets förtroende för banken. Frågan om Riksbankens självständighet gentemot kungamakt, regering eller riksdag kan sägas vara en röd tråd genom historien. Idag pågår en parlamentarisk översyn av det penningpolitiska ramverket och riksbankslagen. Och naturligtvis vågar inte jag mig på någon förutsägelse om hur det kommer att se ut om ytterligare 350 år. Men jag gör ett enkelt konstaterande. Frågan om vår framtida relation kommer att återkomma i olika former. Mina damer och herrar, 350 år av riksbankshistoria lämnar oss något att vara väldigt stolt över. Men också viktigt att reflektera kring.
Nej. Ja.
I ask you to please take your seats. Our next panel consists of four central bankers with an enormous and wide experience in central banking. And it's a great honor for me to introduce Stephanie Flanders as the moderator. Stephanie is now head of Bloomberg Economics and has formerly worked as a journalist at the BBC and also as a chief market strategist at the JP Morgan Asset Management. Please, Stephanie.
Thank you very much, and I'm very glad to be here with this starry cast to talk about the future of central banking. I've encouraged all of the speakers to take a lofty 50-100 year, maybe even 300 year, 350 year stance in their remarks, but I'm sure my colleagues at Bloomberg will notice if they accidentally say anything with a more short-term relevance. We're going to hear from all of the speakers first, briefly, I hope, with some prepared remarks on this topic, and then I hope we will have a lively debate and also a little time for questions. Looking at the panel, we're going to hear from them in the order of age, oldest first, the oldest central bank, that is, rather than necessarily individual representing central bank. Mark Carney, who's been Governor of the Bank of England since 2013. Of course, the Bank of England, as we heard earlier, nearly as old as the Riksbank, 323 years old. Jay Powell has been Chairman of the US Federal Reserve since February. Over 100 years under its belt now, the Federal Reserve. I think the first 100 years, the Riksbank would say the first 100 years is the hardest. Benoît Cœuré, member of the Executive Board of the European Central Bank, which is, of course, the that he's still a teenager, even. Not quite through the difficult adolescence. We will all perhaps be here or somewhere celebrating the 20th anniversary of the UCB next year. Now, Agustin Carstens was until recently running the Bank of Mexico, which is actually a lot older than the ECB, but now, as befits the general manager of the Bank of International Settlements, he has to listen to all these other central bankers and then get his word in at the end. So we will look forward to that. But Governor Carney, do you want to start us off?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Stephanie. Thank you, Stefan, for this invitation, and happy birthday to the Riksbank. It's a great pleasure to be here to discuss some elements of the future of central banking. And given that the Riksbank came first to central banking, it's no surprise that it has a long history of innovation. Its predecessor, as you know, was the first to issue banknotes in Europe, and today the Riksbank is working and leading the transition to a cash-free society. It has been a trailblazer in accountability and transparency for monetary policy for over two decades, publishing an annual evaluation of its effectiveness in achieving the inflation target, and of course, the last decade publishing its own forecast of how policy will evolve to meet that target in the future. And even the minutes of your meetings break new ground at times, rivaling rhetoric for drama, if not style. What shines through, though, through this history, through the 350 years, is an unwavering commitment to the value of money. Indeed, I'd say, and I think everyone on this panel and in this room would agree, that the past, present, and future of central banking comes down to maintaining public confidence in money. And I want to start by what we say when we go to speak to the school children in the United Kingdom about what the Bank of England does. Basically say that's our core job, maintaining public confidence in money. We do it four ways. First, we literally make it. We still produce polymer notes in the UK that people can trust. We process money to the highest standards of resilience, 600 billion pounds per day. Every transaction ultimately goes through the Bank of England. We maintain the value of money through low, stable, predictable inflation. And fourthly, we keep it secure by ensuring the financial system can absorb shocks and serve the real economy so people can get on with their daily business. Now, with an eye to the future, we're innovating across each of those dimensions. In terms of banknotes, I mentioned polymer, stronger, safer, cleaner, and greener. On payments, we are totally rebuilding our RTGS system, and I'm going to come on to in a moment why that matters when I look a little farther out to the future. On monetary policy, as I set out last night in a speech in London, we're using guidance and innovative facilities to achieve our inflation target in the face of a series of supply shocks and regime shifts, and we are well prepared for Brexit, whatever form it takes. And to keep money safe, we've comprehensively overhauled the UK financial system since the crisis, such that it's now resilient to a broad range of severe financial shocks, and I emphasize financial shocks. Liquidity and capital requirements have increased tenfold. Major UK banks now have balance sheets in a position to withstand a cliff-edge Brexit. And we are ending the scourge, we're working to end the scourge of too big to fail. And this year is an important year in that regard because it marks the completion of ring fencing the critical high street or retail banking aspect of the institutions that have been completed this year. And in fact, it's completed in a number of institutions. Looking a little further ahead, I want to outline four fundamental questions that could shape central banking in the decades to come. And I'll start with the future of narrow money. The Bank of England is part of a broad consensus among central bankers that cryptocurrencies do not currently perform the functions of money and that they won't displace public fiat currency. However, we're thinking hard about what the advent of crypto assets reveal about a broader reorganization of the economy into a series of distributed peer-to-peer connections across powerful networks. People are increasingly forming those connections directly, instantaneously, and openly, and this is revolutionizing how they consume, how they work, and how they communicate, and money has to keep up, narrow money has to keep up with those developments. So I mentioned a moment ago that we're revamping our RTGS system. And part of the core of that is to open it up to a much broader range of private sector providers so that we can be in a position for fully reliable, real-time, peer-to-peer retail payments that are cheaper, faster, also, and safer cross-border payments, and more accurate, secure, and speedier wholesale settlement. We're open-minded about the eventual development of a central bank digital currency, though we don't see this as a near-term prospect. Shortcomings in distributed ledger technologies means it's too early to integrate them into private systems. And there are some big policy questions that remain around the general purpose CBDC, a much greater role of the central bank in the financial system, something the previous panel touched upon, getting back into competition, potentially disintermediating commercial banks in normal times, and running the risks of destabilizing flights to quality in times of stress. But we're looking hard at those issues and ways around those issues, and we've recently published research which addresses many of those points on a conceptual basis, though we're still far from solving, I think as a community, far from solving the practical ones. And we will always compare CBDC-like solutions to the potentially more efficient, more immediate, and more robust forms of private payments. In short, we won't use it as a solution in search of a problem or an example of central bankers trying to be down with the kids. And me using that line is an example of central bankers trying to be down with the kids. That's future of narrow money. Second question, future of broad money. We all know that private money dominates the system, and that it can be subject to large booms and busts, times of crisis and repair. Now, I touched on earlier that we have put in place the reforms. They have to be fully implemented, but we put in place the reforms that we think have fixed the fault lines that led to the global financial crisis. But that won't mean a quiet life for central bankers. We know the next crisis will be different. We just don't know how. And so we need to build a more anti-fragile system that's robust to risks that we don't anticipate. That means bridging through higher liquidity, buttressing through higher capital, and being in a position to bury institutions in an orderly way through resolution planning. It also means two other things. One is, and this is on the future agenda, is truly thinking through recognizing the effectiveness of macroprudential policy. Now, we're believers in macroprudential policy at the Bank of England, but there's a question, I think, over time in terms of to what extent is macroprudential policy truly time-varying, or does it is it a series of recalibrations to take out standards that are not suitable for through the cycle? And given the time constraints, I won't expand on that unless anyone's interested. The second thing we need to think about is believing the seriousness of cyber threats. The increased adoption of digital technologies by both individuals and corporations means the surface area, or the attack surface for cyber, has grown significantly and will continue to do so. The financial system is particularly vulnerable because it has complex domestic and international interdependencies, a high degree of concentration, and limited substitutability in key areas. And obviously, it's heavily reliant on data. So we're working with firms to reduce the probability of cyber attacks and to improve the coordination when attacks do occur. That's supremely important. Information sharing, obviously, critical, but unlikely to be sufficient. And ultimately, central banks are going to need to be part of a process that does more to build in contingencies in the face of major operational outages. For example, the one which could immobilize a systemically important bank or infrastructure. Now, the good news is we have a bit of a template for this, the work that has been done to develop resolution and competition agendas have already forced firms to revisit and simplify their operational structures and allow retail customers to move at quick notice, but building that into a cyber agenda may be increasingly important, but at a minimum, an increased focus on operational resilience alongside financial resilience. Thirdly, future of price stability. Inflation targeting has served us well through calm and crisis, certainly in the United Kingdom, and me personally, I'm a firm believer in the value of flexible inflation targeting. Bank and several of the individuals in this room to the theory and practice of that. But we're also learning more about the relationship between price and financial stability, including the role of monetary policy under exceptional circumstances, a debate that has been healthy here in Sweden. And my own personal view is that a healthy focus on price stability can over time become a dangerous distraction, and that there is a requirement for coordination and complementarity with macroprudential policy. I do also think that in the course of the future, there will need to be, that it's desirable to have periodic reviews of the inflation targeting remit. Now, that's something that's built into the UK system. It happens to be built into the Canadian system as well. It is a way to look at potential adjustments in exceptional circumstances, such as we've done in the UK, and such as Ben Bernanke has proposed in the case of the effective lower bound. Process of improving understanding, and ultimately, given where we are, political buy-in and through the Riksdag to the people we serve, true political buy-in and understanding. Last point, which relates to this, is how should we change as institutions, change how we operate to reinforce public trust? We recognize we're in an era of growing distrust of institutions and the experts who reside within them, and the need for central banks to be open and accountable is greater than ever. This will require revisiting how we communicate, we think, how we work, and even who we are. We're trying to, and I'm going to finish by just touching on a few things we're doing at the Bank of England in this respect. With respect to how we communicate, we are publishing much, we have a layered communication approach with different communications, including of our inflation report to different audiences. Our audiences have gone up fivefold in the last year, much stronger engagement with social media. And if I could put it in a sentence that I could only use in this room, our guidance isn't Odyssean or Delphic targeted at central bank watchers, but practical, aimed at the general public. And part of getting into the general public is to go directly to schools and institutions. And over the next 12 months, we will reach 100,000 schools, children at state schools directly through Bank of England visits. The one point, I think, just to link to Barry's excellent presentation on the legitimacy, he had input and output legitimacy is the two ways. I would add to that transmission, the way we talk about the output and how we transmit it and how well it can be received is incredibly important. Finishing off, how we work. I'll encapsulate this by, we are, because it links to my very last point, which is increasing the diversity in the institution. Part of the value of increasing diversity, obviously, is you have to have work processes that are non-hierarchical, that allow actually to get the benefit of these different perspectives. And if I can encapsulate it for the Bank of England, we now make decisions like Amazon. That doesn't mean we ask Alexa whether we should change interest rates, but we literally have taken a series of elements from the Amazon decision-making process, which means when we have meetings, the memos are no longer than 6 pages long. Everybody who's worked on them is in the room. There are clear questions and concise conclusions. And that is not just to save time, not just to save my time, but is to ensure that by bringing together a wider range of people that we actually get the benefit of them. And that is my last point, which is that virtually all the decisions in finance and central banking are taken under uncertainty. And in that environment, unique perspectives and novel approaches are essential in getting more right than wrong. If you want different perspectives, you have to recruit from a broader range of universities. We've quadrupled them in the last several years. You have to take from broader socioeconomic backgrounds, and you have to reach beyond economic So I'll finish here by saying that the future of central banking may, dare I say it, involve fewer central bankers. Thank you very much. Let me also thank you for the great honor of being here to celebrate this important milestone in this beautiful setting. Today is actually a special day for all of us, since the founding of the Riksbank 350 years ago marked the beginning of central banking. And as we meet to discuss the challenges and opportunities that the future may hold, it's worth pausing to note that the 3.5 centuries since the Riksbank's founding have seen economic growth and dynamism, the breadth and duration of which have been unmatched, unprecedented in world history. So the Swedish innovation that we celebrate today, I believe, is a vital part of the financial foundations that support the continuation of rising prosperity. In thinking which view to take of the future today, I chose to explore the road ahead for public transparency and accountability of central banks in a time of intense scrutiny and declining public trust in public institutions in many countries around the world. As you know, the importance of transparency and accountability to monetary policymaking was recognized and became firmly entrenched in practice over the past few decades. And the Riksbank has been a leader in this transparency revolution, among many others. So today I will focus principally on the less often emphasized but critically important role transparency and accountability play in regulatory and financial stability policies. And to preview my conclusions, public transparency and accountability around both financial stability and monetary policy have become all the more important in light of the extraordinary actions taken by central banks in the global financial crisis. Financial stability policymaking has evolved from managing individual crises as they arise to establishing a policy framework that emphasizes prevention. This framework now includes measures to increase the resiliency of the financial system, enhanced monitoring of financial institutions and of building risks to the system, and measures such as resolution planning that require firms to take steps today to better prepare for future episodes of stress. These innovations place special demands on transparency and accountability, and we have worked hard as central banks to explain them to the public. But the framework is still evolving, and we will need to remain open to making changes and to new ways to enhance transparency and accountability. This is clearly a challenging moment for central banking. Opinion polls show that trust in government and public institutions is at historic lows. In this environment, central banks cannot take our measure of independence for granted. For monetary policy, the case for central bank independence rests on the demonstrated benefits of insulating monetary policy decisions from shorter-term political considerations. But for a quarter of a century, inflation has been low and inflation expectations anchored. And we may be tempted to, but must not forget, the lessons of the past when a lack of central bank independence led to episodes of runaway inflation and subsequent economic contractions. As for financial stability, the crisis and the severe recession that followed revealed serious flaws at many private and public institutions, including shortcomings in supervision and regulation. The crisis and its aftermath led central banks to take extraordinary actions that challenged the ingenuity of experts in the field and were understandably difficult to explain and to justify to a skeptical public. While these actions were authorized by law and on the whole necessary to avert the complete collapse of the financial system, they may also have contributed to the erosion of public trust. Central banks are assigned narrow but important mandates. For monetary policy, the Federal Reserve's mandate is to keep inflation low and stable and to achieve maximum employment. For financial sector supervision and regulation, part of our mandate is to foster the safety and soundness of individual institutions. In addition, we have a responsibility shared with other government agencies to promote financial stability. And I view this responsibility as being highly complementary to other aspects of our mission. Financial stability promotes sustainable economic growth, and a stable, well-functioning financial system is an effective transmission channel for monetary policy. Indeed, there can be no macroeconomic stability without financial stability. Within our narrow mandates to safeguard against political interference, central banks are afforded instrument independence, that is, considerable freedom to choose the means to achieve legislatively assigned goals. While the focus is frequently on monetary policy independence, research suggests that a degree of independence in regulatory and financial stability matters improves the stability of the banking system and leads to better outcomes. For this reason, governments in many countries, including the United States, have granted some institutional and budgetary independence to their financial regulators. In a democratic system, any such degree of independence brings with it the obligation to provide appropriate transparency. In turn, transparency provides an essential basis for accountability and democratic legitimacy by enabling effective legislative oversight and keeping the public informed. Of course, central banks also need to stick closely to our mandates. The case for independence weakens to the extent that central banks stray into issues that the legislature has not assigned to us. There's also an important policy effectiveness argument in favor of transparency. In the financial stability arena, there is no better example of this than the role that the first round of stress tests played during the crisis in restoring confidence in the U.S. banking system. This is the SCAP tests. So in the financial stability realm, the case for enhanced transparency is not just about being accountable. It is also about providing credible information that can help restore and sustain public confidence in the financial system. Indeed, the post-crisis regulatory system recognizes the importance of enhanced transparency, both about financial institutions themselves and about the processes and expectations of regulators and supervisors. Before the crisis, supervision focused on the safety and soundness of individual institutions and was insufficiently attentive to risk in the financial system as a whole. Supervisory judgments about firms were shared with the public only in rare and exceptional circumstances. Financial stability tools were generally deployed after the fact to address specific events that emerged to threaten stability. It is an understatement to say that this approach proved inadequate in the crisis. So the post-crisis regime has shifted to implementing preventive policies well in advance of any crisis, the resilience of institutions by requiring more and higher quality capital and liquidity buffers, a regime of stress tests undertaken by supervisors, and resolution planning, which requires firms to analyze their own potential for distress or failure and create a plan to be used in the event of bankruptcy. These post-crisis policies have benefited from public solicitation of feedback and, in many cases, from consideration in open meetings of the Board of Governors. Transparency and incorporation of public feedback in these areas have produced more effective supervision and regulation. For example, transparent and clearly communicated policies make it easier for regulated entities to know what is expected of them and how best to comply. Of course, as with any large-scale complex undertaking, the standards adopted over the past decade can undoubtedly be improved, and at the Fed, we're committed to transparency as we assess the efficacy and efficiency of post-crisis reforms. In a sense, stress testing itself is a step forward in transparency. Before the crisis, supervisors' views of the risks facing our most systemically important firms and the firm's ability to understand and manage these risks were shrouded in secrecy. After the crisis, as part of our stress testing regime, these supervisory views and expectations are transparent. We expect that these firms will have capital, liquidity, and risk management capabilities that are adequate for the firms not only to survive, but to continue to perform their key functions even in the event of truly severe stress along the lines of the global financial crisis. We make a great deal of information regarding the stress tests public, including the scenarios we use, portfolio level projected losses for participating firms, and of course, the results. We've also proposed for public comment a range of ways to further enhance the transparency of the supervisory stress tests. And all of this detailed disclosure provides the public with a wealth of information on how these institutions would perform under severe stress should it emerge. It also both enhances public confidence and holds banking regulators accountable for our judgments. We also use a variety of additional means to enhance public understanding, including testimony by the Vice Chair for Supervision twice a year, the Board staff's assessment of financial stability, which is presented to the Federal Open Market Committee four times a year and finds its way into our minutes, and finally, the semi-annual monetary report that we give to Congress always now includes a section on financial stability. So turning to the way forward, this post-crisis framework remains novel and it remains unfamiliar. Some of these new policies, particularly stress testing and resolution planning, are inherently complex and challenging for all involved. As a result, transparency and accountability around financial stability tools present particular challenges. So we will continue to strive to find better ways to enhance transparency around financial stability. Efforts to engage with the public, consumer groups, academics, and the financial sector, we expect to lead to improved policies. An ongoing dialogue will work to enhance public trust as well as our ability to adapt to new threats as they emerge. To wrap up, there's every reason to expect that technology and communications will continue to rapidly evolve and to affect the financial system and financial stability in ways that we can't anticipate. While future innovations may well improve the delivery of financial services and even make the system stronger, they will also contain, some of them, the seeds of potential future systemic vulnerabilities. So we'll need to keep up with the pace of innovation, which will doubtless require changes to our approach to financial stability. And as we consider these changes, it will remain critically important to provide transparency and accountability. By doing so, we strengthen the foundation of democratic legitimacy that enables central banks to serve the needs of our citizens in the long and proud tradition of the Riksbank. Thank you.
Good afternoon and happy birthday to the Riksbank, and thank you very much, Stefan, for inviting me to present the youngest of all central banks on this panel. 20-year-old, and I cannot resist but quoting a French writer, Paul Nizan, who started a novel saying, "I was 20, and I will not let anybody say that this is the best age in life." Meaning that I have a lot of sympathy for Charles Goodhart's statement that the next 20 years could be as difficult as the first 20 years. And I took some comfort this morning in the first panel hearing that it's actually the first 100 years which are the most difficult. And I'm quite certain that the ECB will be around to discuss it at the 450th anniversary of the Riksbank. So and by the way, we have a lot to learn from the Riksbank, as we have a lot, being young, we have a lot to learn from the wisdom of those who came before us. For instance, the discussion on the digital currencies, which Mark Carney alluded to, I'm not going to speak about that, but it's very clear that when we discuss the future of money, when we discuss the future of central bank liabilities, there is a lot to learn from the past. And as Stefan often tells us, we've been there already, discussing the future of banknotes 1 century ago, and also 2 centuries ago, and also 3 centuries ago, in different ways. So it's only new aspects of a very old discussion. So what I would like to do in my remarks is to address the topic of the panel from one particular angle, which has been touched upon by Mark and Jay, but I would like to elaborate a little bit more and differently, given our perspective, which is communication and trust in the central bank. The point I would like to make is that central bank independence may have been challenged by one legacy of the crisis, which is the fact that our toolkits have become more complex. Before the crisis, no one needed to know the technical details of monetary policy. We would move rates up and down, and that would make our intentions clear to a broad audience. And suddenly, with the arrival of non-standard measures, in different ways, in different places, the operational details started to matter. Take asset purchases. The public is right to ask questions when they are told that the central bank is printing money, well, a lot of money actually. And if we want to order these questions, we need to explain the nature of the different central bank liabilities. We have to explain the assets we're buying, why we're buying them, and there are different subtexts, different backgrounds in different places. Private assets, public assets have different implications in different jurisdictions, given our different financial structures, given our different political environments. So we have At the ECB, we have to explain that we buy government bonds according to our capital key, that we most of the risk is actually not shared between participating central banks. We have to explain that corporate bonds also are purchased according to the market portfolio. We're not taking industrial decisions when we do that, etc., etc. And we also have to rectify a misperception on the distributional consequences of non-standard measures. There is a widespread belief that asset purchases have contributed to making the rich richer, which of course neglects the fact that monetary policy always has distributional effects. As we learned at school, monetary policy is about shifting resources from future to present and back to future. That's how it works. And it also neglects that asset purchases were quite powerful, very powerful actually, in supporting the most vulnerable in our societies, that is those without a job. And that effect dominates actually when you run the map. But perceptions matter. Central banks are of course not the only institutions which grapple with complexity. But there is a crucial difference. If citizens are not happy with health services, taxation, water supply, bioethics, they can voice their opinion at the ballot box. The next government will change it. But we're independent. Which means that citizens unimpressed with our actions cannot simply elect a new central bank governor. And some political scientists, which I'm not, but some political scientists would see it as a symptom of what has been called undemocratic liberalism, which is citizens' rights are respected, but they feel that their preferences are not understood or not taken into account. And nobody wants to be forced to choose between undemocratic liberalism and illiberal democracy. So as central bankers, we've got something to do here to make it clear what we're doing and why we're doing it. So as was rightly said, I guess it's Barry Eigengreen who rightly said in the first panel that it's both about input legitimacy and output legitimacy, and we know that. And as far as the ECB is concerned, we have a very strong framework to deliver input legitimacy. And that's about the treaty. EU treaty has been voted, and that's also about accountability that we have when we explain what we're doing. Pre-crisis, this position was largely unchallenged. There was broad public support for central bank independence, and the reason was simple: people trusted independent central banks. But that trust has become more fragile, and that's the point Jay made in his remarks. Eurozone, for example, the latest survey suggests that 47% of euro area citizens don't trust the ECB. 47%. When you look into the numbers, they trust their national institutions even less, as a matter of fact, which cannot come as a comfort to us. So we've got to, that's something we have to be serious about. So there are different possible reasons why this might be the case. For example, legitimacy might be more difficult to assert if monetary policy transmission's lag has become longer, which arguably is the case today, or if domestic macroeconomic conditions are being increasingly affected by global developments. That blurs output legitimacy, and in a sense, it makes independence more difficult to assert and to explain. But another reason why trust in independent central banks may be waning is more simply in a sense that our actions have become more complex. And if this is the case, then we need to think more deeply about how this affects our accountability and how we plan to maintain trust among the general public. So I think that we can master these challenges, but not alone. So there are things we should do, but there are things that also should be done to help us do it, to help us do what we do. So, first, that's about strengthening central bank communication. Mark has spoke to it, so I'm not going to be very long here. I guess we, in different ways, we share the same objectives of broadening, diversifying, and changing the way we communicate to people. One thing, for example, is that central banks probably have concentrated too much on interacting with experts. And what we say is actually quite difficult to grasp sometimes. If you go through the last introductory statement of the ECB Governing Council based on a common measure of text readability, the statement was accessible only to university graduates. That's what the test says. That's about one third of the Eurozone population. So that cannot be good news. We need to do more. We need to have a more differentiated communication strategy. So we have to go to schools. We have to go to social media. We have a Twitter account, for instance, which has over 400,000 followers. 400,000 followers. Last year, we added 42,000 followers to the Twitter account. Our question is whether Delphic forward guidance can be expressed in 280 characters. So that creates new challenges, but we should try. We can increase our transparency, which we do. So we're now publishing an account of our monetary policy discussion, as you know. We're publishing the diaries of executive board members. And I'm quite convinced that this is only a first step and more steps will have to be taken. But we should also recognize that communication is a two-way street. That is, we can't do it alone. And complexity poses challenges that go beyond our remit in different ways. But let me just, as a conclusion, flag three ways where complexity can be addressed outside of central banks to help us deliver on our mandate and discharge our accountability duties. The first one is specific to the Eurozone, and that's about what I would call nicely diversity, but which also too often is fragmentation or divergence. The financial crisis in the Eurozone has at the same time raised expectations toward the central bank. And that's a point what Meissing made in his remarks, which I fully agree, that the economic policy framework was largely dysfunctional, which has raised a lot of expectations toward the ECB. But it also has created divergent expectations toward the ECB because of economic divergence across member states or within member states. Also because of financial fragmentation. So at the same time, some would like us to raise rates, some would like us not to raise rates, some would like us to do QE, some would like us not to do QE, and so on and so forth. This happens everywhere, but even more so in an economic area which has been under strain with the crisis. So there is a simple answer to that, which is fostering convergence in the Eurozone, completing banking union, capital market union, fight fragmentation and deepening the institutional framework of our monetary union, which is not something the ECB can do. And we have little to say about it in a sense, but that's something political leaders should do to help us also do what we do. That would clearly facilitate the conduct of the single monetary policy. Second point is much broader. It's about financial literacy. Only a small majority of adults in our countries understand how inflation affects their purchasing power. That's what the OECD surveys tell us. In Germany, only one out of two people know who Mario Draghi is. So whether this is good news or bad news, I leave it to you. That is, it's a fact. So there's a lot more need to be done to improve financial literacy. And the starting point here is primary and secondary schools. We can help, but of course central banks cannot do it alone. And the third implication I would like to flag here is about diversity, which also Mark mentioned. The economic profession generally struggles with lack of diversity, which also affects public acceptance of what economists have to say. In our governing council, only two members of the governing council are women. In the economic profession more broadly, only one woman has ever won the Riksbank Prize in Economic Science, the Nobel Prize, and that's Elinor Ostrom, as we know. One of the best economists of all time, John Robertson, never received the Nobel Prize. And it may be no coincidence that she once said that the purpose of studying economics is to learn how to be deceived by economists. It just tells you how also lack of diversity sometimes might erode trust in the profession more generally beyond central banking. So there is a lot we can do inside our institutions to promote diversity. We're doing it, but this cannot substitute for more resolute action by European leaders to appoint more women on our governing council and on our executive board. It can help address the issues at, its, at their root, and it will make our monetary policy better. Let's stop here.
I've been looking to see whether there are any polls of whether the public has heard of any of the other panelists, but I haven't been able to find them yet.
Okay, well, I'll start by thanking Stefan Ingves from the Riksbank for having invited me to this very prestigious panel and to this great event, and also thank Urban Alin and Susan Eberstein for hosting us here at the Riksdag. The Riksbank journey from public saving banks to modern central bank epitomizes the central bank as an adaptive, learning, and improving organization. Often crisis spurs adaptation, as it did in 2008. The Riksbank evolution points to broad trends in central banking towards fiat money, public governance, centralized payments, and the lender of last resort role. I submit that these trends will persist. However, we have not reached the end of the story. In important respects, central banking cycles, or at least fluctuates. Should central banks favor government bonds as assets? What relative weights to assign to price stability and financial stability? How independent should the central bank be? Different times give different answers. I would like to organize my reflections on these and other topics into four trends and three cycles. Along the way, I argue that public, centralized, large payment systems will survive advancing technology. I close with some thoughts on central bank independence and cooperation. Let me start with four trends in central banking. The bar for reversing any of them looks high. First, one trend is from metallic convertibility to fiat money. Historically, fiat money was at best a temporary war expedient and at worst a breach of trust. Today, institutional credibility grounds price expectations, not gold. The Riksbank deserves credit for having pioneered non-convertible paper money and being one of the first central banks to adopt an inflation targeting framework, basically trying to anchor inflation expectations. Second, also taking a long perspective, a second trend is from private to public governance of central banks. No one laments the 1947 nationalization of the Bank of England. After its private for-profit predecessor failed, the Riksbank started as a public institution in 1668. Precisely because of this, I fully echo the call for transparency and accountability to preserve the trust of the people that has been advocated by my colleagues. A third trend is toward the centralization of the payment systems at the national or regional level in the case of the euro area. A state monopoly of the large payment system became the international standard by the mid-20th century. Only such infrastructure offers finality so that the payment discharges the debt irrevocably. Today, Fedwire, Target 2, and the BOJ wire dominate the turnover league. The Riksbank's RIX system settles transactions amounting to one time Swedish GDP every week. The fourth trend is for the central bank to lend in the last resort to relieve financial crises. Whether first done in the 18th or 19th centuries, once this practice begins, it tends to continue. In the great financial crisis, central banks innovated in last resort lending. Internationally, the Riksbank, a pioneer in foreign currency last resort lending, joined a broad effort in 2008 to relieve a global dollar shortage that shrank Swedish banks' cross-currency funding. These trends to a public centralized payment system backed by last resort lending leave me skeptical that new technology will displace central bank money. First, like the Riksbank's ill-fated predecessor, private money's founder on self-serving over issuance. Second, once market participants have enjoyed finality of payments, they will not abandon it. Third, cryptocurrency creators' effort to separate money from a trusted institution burdens it with congestion. More use increases the size of the blockchain, but decreases efficiency. By contrast, incumbent central bank monies enjoy a virtuous cycle from network externalities. The more use a money, the greater my incentive to use it. In sum, central bank money enjoys a scalable network. The more, the merrier. Blockchain creates a congestion. The more, the sorrier. To be sure, central banks will champion new technology, as they have with digital payments, but this would be an evolution of the present publicly run centralized and digital system. Let me turn now to cyclic, or at least changeable, aspects of central bank governance and functions. Let me consider three. First, the holding of government debt as the preferred central bank domestic asset varies. Some fear excessive central bank credit to the government as the greatest risk, even if bonds are bought in the market, as it usually happens nowadays. Others contend that the central bank holding anything but government debt allocates credit and therefore resources, as fiscal policy does. Norms change, however. At the outset, the Federal Reserve was set up to hold bank-related domestic assets, not government bonds. By contrast, the Riksbank has long held government debt. My bottom line is that the composition of central bank's assets should not be subject to dogma. It should respond to the policy needs that the institution faces at a particular point in time to achieve its mandate. The mandate is the anchor, and in most cases it includes or it is price stability. Second, the weights assigned to price stability on the one hand and financial stability on the other also vary. The United States provides a good example. The original Federal Reserve Act sought an elastic currency to assure financial stability. In 1926-1928, the head of the Federal Reserve Bank of New York argued to Congress against the Federal Reserve mandate for stable prices, given the imprecision of its control. The Fed legislated dual mandate dates only to 1977. Somewhat related is whether the central bank has responsibility for banking supervision. The widespread impulse to change that responsibility after a financial crisis had led to cycling. Sweden stands out here. After the banking crisis of the early 1990s, the legislature strengthened supervision but did not move it into the central bank. It is worth noticing that in theory and practice, we really still have not fully mastered an integrated framework for monetary and financial stability. We follow with great interest the Riksdag considerations of the Riksbank role in financial stability and parallel discussions elsewhere. Third, despite recent events, central bank independence varies, at least in the choice of means to agreed ends. Variation in independence arises not only from legal but also behavioral sources, such as the timing of the appointment of the central bank head in the political cycle. Most, but not all, BIS members enjoy substantial independence to pursue agreed goals. War apart, we can recognize two current challenges to central bank independence. first adaptation of monetary policy to unprecedented conditions has left some central banks with huge domestic asset holdings, including government securities, as it was pointed out in the last panel. Even with the best of will and communication, undoing this could prove delicate. But domestic assets must be reduced, privileging monetary control. Fiscal dominance is just not an option, and I tell you this coming from a region of the world where this is often ignored. Second, financial stability mandates pose challenges to the model of agreed goals and independent means. Such mandates resist the clarity of an inflation target. What is more, financial stability is most often a shared responsibility. Sweden Financial Supervisory Authority and National Debt Office both have financial stability tasks. To achieve financial stability, the central bank cannot be the only game in town. I am confident that we will rise to these challenges. My bet is that the Riksbank 400th anniversary central bank independence will be a trend. To get there, we should embrace clear goals, articulate the means to reach them, and engage with elected officials and the public in general, as my colleagues have already advocated for. I close on what I hope will be a trend rather than a cycle: central banks' cooperation. With global financial markets, central bankers value Basel discussion of policy spillovers and spillbacks. Understanding this enlightens self-interest in the pursuit of national mandates. Often, Basel discussions lead to joint action. Ben Bernanke recalled that, and I quote, a number of cooperative efforts among central banks had their origin at Basel meetings, especially during the crisis. Extensive cooperation in banking supervision owes much to Governor Ingves' time, devotion and steely determination. BIS member central banks, both those he represented and others, hope that Sweden will continue to overachieve in central bank cooperation. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, all of you, for also being disciplined in your remarks. I was really struck. You know, you could have talked about anything related to the future of central banking, but so many of you chose to talk about the challenge of communication and the relationship between communication and public trust. We spend a lot of time listening to every word you say because of the connection with the markets and the development of forward guidance, all those things. But in retrospect, do you think you've spent too much time talking to markets and not enough time talking to the public? Mark Carney, talking too much?
I think sometimes you think we're talking to markets when we're talking to the public. You know, the general message of limited and gradual rate increases, that has been a message that we have been talking about for the last several years, has been a message directly to households and businesses in the country to prepare for that. And the first thing we've looked at in terms of expectations of that is how have household expectations and business expectations moved in that direction. Because remember, the received, still the history of rate cycles has been very sharp in the UK. We're in a different environment. It's worn out. That expectation has been worn out. And now it's understood that it's commonly understood. So now, when you speak to the public, repeat, 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 repeat. So that's not necessarily talking too much. It is when you get really bored and saying, I'm bored of saying limited and gradual, trust me, but that's, as you see, it actually take hold. Now, last point, of course we have to be conscious of how markets can interpret these things, but the hierarchy is the people we serve first, and then the markets.
But if as has been so often the case in the last few years, if the main focus of policy is around forward guidance, is around communications, where you're trying to achieve a target, achieve an end in financial markets.
No. That you just didn't listen to what I said. I just said the objective is first and foremost for achieving an understanding in the public about the path of policy. Past history, and past history of the Bank of England, given the MPC exactly right in order to achieve the inflation target in those circumstances, with a recovery that started with the force of the recovery in 2013 in the UK, was within a year we would have that's past history. Trying to get across to people that that's not what we're going to do is really important. In the current environment in the United Kingdom, where the economy is growing at a slower pace than it had been historically, but is still, not in the first quarter, but is still using up slack and gradually building inflationary pressures, welcome domestically generated inflation, getting across that some modest rate increases will be needed to the general public is still important. And I think as well one needs to step back and look at where market expectations have been and how much they've actually moved around. Short rate volatility is very low. It's very low. I mean, relative to history, we're down into single digit percentiles. So there's a lot of stories on your employer's terminals around this, and I can understand why. But again, in terms of transmission mechanism, getting the message to people who make decisions, consumption, savings, investment, hiring, that's what we're trying to do.
I'm interested, Chairman Powell, is that how you think of communication? When you are talking at a press conference, which, as you know, every word is being pored over by the financial markets, are you really speaking first to the public, or are you thinking maybe first, not necessarily the most important point, but first about the financial market?
First thing I do in those press conferences is try not to think that the whole world is listening.
Well, good luck with that.
Yeah. I guess I think of it this way, if I can take a swing at this. So I think we do a good job of explaining ourselves to financial markets, to economists, and to professional Fed watchers. If you look at all of the machinery of inflation targeting, there's a lot of information, there's a lot of data. It's pretty well understood now. We're close to the frontier on that. And I think as it relates to traditional monetary policy and financial supervision and regulation, we have transparency, we have accountability, we have democratic legitimacy. I think, as Michael Bordeaux was talking about and others this morning, as you move into unconventional monetary policy and post-crisis financial stability, we have work to do. So, and I think we're all aware of that and we're doing it. So, frankly, press conferences are mainly the focus of that first group of professionals. I think as you talk about financial stability and unconventional monetary policy, which some would say gets closer to distributional effects, you need to think of the general public, and you need to communicate specifically with that audience through different channels, as we're all trying to do.
Benoit, go ahead.
No, I also think that the two audiences, the two constituencies, are complementary. So we need to talk more and better to the general public, which is what we all said in different ways. And there is a lot that we can improve here in terms of reaching out to more people, speaking in using plain words, plain English, plain German, plain French, etc., which we are not doing enough, probably. We have to talk to financial markets because asset prices are driven by expectations. So it's an essential part of monetary policy transmission. Communication is an essential tool of monetary policy. And we have to do it. What we might be doing too much is to listen to financial markets, which is a different discussion. There's a metaphor which Paul Samuelson once used, which is a monkey in the mirror, right? The monkey starts moving its arms, and the other monkey on the other side of the mirror also starts moving its arms, and then you feel compelled to react to the other monkey, and at the end you're confused. So that's a little bit the story of the central banker talking to markets.
Well, it's a good point, though, because some people feel that the fact there has been all this communication and forward guidance has left the markets feeling that too relaxed, almost, that there's always this sort of guarantee that anything that happens is not going to happen automatically. worry about that. Whichever.
Right, so it was always thought when forward guidance came around that, I mean, the whole point of getting a market signal is that there's independent content in that signal. If the market's really signaling that it understands what it thinks we're doing, then you've lost the content of the signal. So, you know, I think forward guidance was highly useful in the crisis for reasons that much discussed and well understood, and I think it will have a significantly smaller role going forward.
That's interesting. Everyone was struck by Charles Goodhart's comment in the previous panel. The implication of some of these concerns around the credibility and the public trust having gone down for central bankers and all parts of the establishment is a threat to independence from populist politicians. But do you agree with him that there's going to be more threats from that direction in the next few years?
I mean, I think that my nationality helps. I mean, not Mexico is right now in a difficult economic situation, but I come from a region where populism has been very damaging. I mean, Latin America, some emerging markets, we have had some subsequent crises. And I think, I mean, what I sense being at the BIS and being at panels like these, panels where you have the main central banks of the world, but there is another huge part of the world that is not necessarily in the minds of public like this. And those are emerging market economies where a basic degree of discipline is not observed. And I think that the level of confidence you have achieved in advanced economies on institutions like central banks is a huge asset. So I think that you should do everything you can to preserve that. And therefore, I honestly think that you should not only talk to markets in terms of in the public and the legislators, not only in terms of what you are doing, but also to come back and back and back and back again at the objective. I think that what is the objective is what is key. The key is to have predictability. If you're in the circumstance where you have rampant inflation, that really destroys societies. It really destroys societies. And it's something that you want to avoid at all costs. So I think that you have to be very persistent, even in peace times, even at times where inflation is low, that inflation is an important objective to defeat.
When we talk about the populist threat, about the future, the threat to independence, I mean, we're seeing it right now in Turkey. Do you think that is a sign? Will we see other examples of that? Are you concerned by the dynamic we've seen play out in Turkey? Go on, one of you.
Where, you know, the governments have tried to interfere with the central bank decisions, and let me bring one to the table, and that's the case of Argentina. I mean, one of the problems that Argentina has faced in the last months, right now things are stable, but is because the central bank was forced to change its inflation target by the government, and that obviously affected the market. Now I don't think that was necessarily a populist movement by the government, but at the same time it really generated major problems for Argentina. So I think that respect the autonomy of the central bank is really important.
Maybe I can add a word in the case of the Eurozone, which has such a particular setup that our governing council is, as Otmar reminded us this morning, earlier today, our governing council is 6 board members and 19 governors. Governors have a dual role. They are voting members of the governing council. They have to vote in the interest of the Eurozone. That's written in the treaty. But they're also heads of the national central banks and part of the national economic policy discussion, as they should be. And so there is always a temptation for political pressures on all of us, probably more on national governors and board members, but still, which is why the treaty has given us very strong safeguards in terms of independence. But these safeguards are needed. So it has been difficult in the past. It will remain difficult for the reasons that were explained, because all institutions are now challenged in our democracies. So it's not specific to central banks. And maybe for another reason which hasn't been thrown in the discussion yet, which is that the international framework system on which we are resting is also being challenged. So as the multilateral system is now being challenged, sometimes attacked, the foundations on which the way we work are built are also weakened, and that will create that may create insecurity in the way we deliver on our mandates.
Just one more point on legitimacy and independence, and kind of picking up on Chairman Powell's remarks around financial stability and macroprudential is, I mean, part of the challenge with macroprudential or successful financial stability policy is it's an orphan. You know, this is the one place where success is an orphan as opposed to failure, because you can't prove the counterfactual of what would have happened. And so it is, is one of the things that we struggle with in terms of how to get across that we have hit that right. So we think we've got to the right zone in terms of the amount of capital, liquidity, the operational structure, the resolution plan of institutions that is providing the stability that they is fundamental to our legitimacy, given that we have these responsibilities, and fundamental to good economic outcomes. That isn't the stability of the graveyard. And striking that balance and communicating that in a way, even to some very seasoned observers of these things, is candidly, it's difficult. And we're working, learning from the Fed, learning from the European process, other processes, in terms of how we conduct stress tests, and how we communicate that, how we communicate around resolution plans in a way that can be challenged, appropriately be challenged, so we're accountable, but also get across the message that actually some pretty fundamental things have changed in the system over the course of the last 10 years, because that's absolutely essential. I'll just finish with this. If you look at the UK, where the system as a whole is 10 times the size of GDP, you know, for the small p political legitimacy of that system, that big financial system, people have to have the confidence that things have changed, and that a large institution can be resolved without consequences for the real economy.
Very briefly, yeah.
Just to add a very short comment, to navigate in these very stormy waters, I think very deeply that having a simple mandate will help. It has served us very well at the ECB to have a narrow mandate which is focused on price stability, and which we've narrowed even more with a number, etc. So doing too many things, having broad mandates, might sound good in terms of having broad discretion to do what you have to do, but it makes accountability much more challenging.
Looking forward a little bit, I mean, the fiscal dominance was mentioned by Mr. Carstens. I mean, almost whatever happens, you're going to go into the next recession, not necessarily crisis, but recession, with significantly higher public debt across the board, which is a legacy from the previous crisis. How does that affect independence, but also the room for maneuver of the central bank in trying to confront the next recession? Come on, guys. Well, I'm not going to let the actual central bank governors completely off the hook. Mark?
Well, it depends. It depends when it is. We would like to target a sort of Australian business cycle, which is running in the 27th year of continuous expansion. So if we get there, maybe the public debt situation will be different. It's no secret that I'll put it in context for the UK, which is that on average, a interest rate cycle, given the structure of borrowing in the UK, as you know, floating rate, or if it's fixed rate, it's only temporarily fixed rate. An interest rate cycle in the UK is on average somewhere between around 150 basis points. I mean, there's been some that have been higher, some obviously a bit lower, but on average 150, 175 basis points. So you get a lot of traction moving bank rate within a relatively short period of time. Unless
US gross debt relative to GDP is now on course to be the same as Italy's in a few years' time. That changes the calculation of the next recession, surely.
It's a fact that the United States is not on a sustainable fiscal path. It's a serious problem, and now is a great time to be working on it when the economy is strong, unemployment is low, there's momentum in the economy. It's also a great time to be working on it because, as Mark mentioned, we're close to the zero lower bound. So it may be, given that depending on the timing and the scale of the next downturn, whenever it comes, it may be that we had pushed back to the zero lower bound and we'll need to either resort to unconventional measures or to have some fiscal support. I would say, though, that for the United States, in my view, this is more of a medium and longer term problem. It's not literally the case that we wouldn't have fiscal space to respond in the next few years. That is not the case. Nonetheless, it is a problem that needs addressing urgently in the United States.
I'm conscious that we have people who also might want to ask questions, and we're going to run out of time. So it's a brief moment for a question. Yeah, just here.
So, Anders Borg, let me just congratulate the Riksbank for the 350-year anniversary and then raise a difficult issue. Today, the bond spread on Italian 10 years had gone up 10 basis points. When I was slightly younger, in the 90s, when I started trading in the Swedish bond market, the bond rates could go 30 and 40 and 50 basis points in a day in a situation where debt sustainability was put in question. The reason why a country with 130% in debt, almost no growth, and the labor market system that has provided consistent too high wage increases to productivity can trade at 2.5 percentage point is that the central banks are providing a sterilization of the political risk factor in Italy, and that might contribute, one could argue, to unsustainable and very populistic policies. So, wouldn't it be interesting to hear some reflections on whether actually there is a risk that central bank containing these risks can actually create a moral hazard for a country like Italy?
I'm very interested in hearing the answer to that question. Benoit Corbet.
Anders, you will be very disappointed, but you can understand that it's very difficult to comment on actions to be taken by a government which is not yet in place. We've been discussing trust and accountability, so it starts also with a respect for the democratic process. That's where it starts. So when there is an Italian government, we'll engage with them. We'll see what are their plans. We'll see what are their plans within the EU rules, and we'll see what are the consequences. But it's really too early to have that discussion.
I guess it would be fair to say, looking at the tools that are there now, for responding to a problem a country like Italy might have. A democratic government that decided it did not want to follow the tough policies required to qualify for support from the Eurozone will not get it?
I guess the answer is a question.
Well, maybe the markets should pay more attention to that absence. Is there another question? Right at the back.
Imagine you could travel into the future 25 years ahead. And what would you expect to meet when you were evaluated from your colleagues 25 years into the future regarding the present period of unconventional monetary policy methods?
Are you thinking about a grade?
Sorry?
Are you thinking what grade they would get? I'm wondering what's your...
Yeah.
So that would be good for a brief answer. What grade do you think you'll get looking back?
Great question to ask, terrible question to answer. I'm not going to give a grade. I think those who are marking our exam papers, though, will start with our objectives, and we'll see how well we achieved our objectives. So starting with whether we've achieved our inflation target and subject to that. Reduced unwarranted volatility and output and employment, and the steps we have financial side, the effectiveness of those will be revealed by 25 years down the road. They will have been properly tested in a way that obviously everyone, even an Augusta body is in this room, cannot truly mark that exam paper right now.
I'm tempted to say that, as I think Ho Chi Minh said about the French Revolution, it's too soon to say. But if you were, the test is not over. We haven't normalized monetary policy. We haven't seen the aftermath fully. I think if you were trying to write that story today, I would say, if I were writing it today, I would say that these tools, which were invented in the stress of a very severe, historically large crisis, largely accomplished their purposes, largely didn't produce the downsides that were widely predicted, such as very high inflation and unsustainably high asset prices and credit growth. We don't see those things. Nonetheless, the moral hazard problem that was, I guess, the last question really hangs in the air. And I don't think we'll really be able to grade that paper for a few more years.
Very, very, very similar answer when it comes to monetary policy and inflation. It's too early to tell. That has to be assessed over a full cycle, and we're not yet there. Some of the unintended consequences of what we're doing we'll see only later, maybe. So here we need some depth to judge. But where I would give ourselves a good grade, because that was a question, is on actions taken by the ECB to fight fragmentation in the early times of the Eurozone crisis. Divergence in lending rates to small companies in Germany and Spain, for instance, fragmentation all across the board in the Eurozone. This has been addressed very successfully by long-term refinancing operations, by the existence of the OMT, and also by QE. So that's first phase, in a sense. I think we have enough depth to judge, and that has been a success. What we're doing today is too early to tell.
Well, my opinion is that so far, so good. I think central banks have done a very good job.